When we look at the international arrangements on trademarks, we find that most of the arrangements started off with the Paris Convention in 1883. That is the point at which there was a need to have an international arrangement on trademarks. Then we had the Madrid Agreement, which pertained to registration of trademarks. Then the Madrid Protocol in 1989. And we had international registration under the WIPO and certain substantive measures under the TRIPS Agreement. So international registration itself came about with the Madrid Agreement. The Paris Convention in 1883 brought out the principle of national treatment, which is something which we had already seen, which said that foreign marks will be protected just in the same manner as national or domestic marks will be protected. It kind of preserved the priority. You could file a foreign mark. It kind of preserved the priority. You could file a mark in the domestic country and then get it registered in a foreign country. So foreign country registrations were allowed, provided an application was made in the country of origin. But apart from this, the Paris Convention did not have anything which could enable international registration for trademarks. That came about in the Madrid Agreement in 1891. And that was further enhanced by the Madrid Protocol in 1989. This brought a system of international registration where you could file a home application and later on follow it up with applications in different countries. Something similar to the arrangement that we had under the Patent Cooperation Treaty. Now the final arrangement pertains to the protection for trademarks under the TRIPS Agreement in 1994, which came into effect in 1995. Now, the TRIPS Agreement provided for service marks as well. The recent version of the Trademarks Act, that is the Trademarks Act 1999, provide for trademarks for goods and services. And service marks were introduced in 1999 pursuant to India's obligation under the TRIPS Agreement. So it provided for service marks. It characterized likelihood of confusion as a reason why other marks should not be allowed, because that could lead to likelihood of confusion. And it also provided for indefinite registration. Indefinite registration is unique amongst other intellectual property rights to trademarks. Trademarks can be indefinitely renewed, and the period of registration can be renewed is 10 years. So every 10 years, trademarks can be renewed indefinitely. Intellectual property rights like patents, copyright, and designs are time-bound rights. They are also referred to as limited life IP, intellectual property having limited life. Trademark does not have a limited life. It has an unlimited life, but the unlimited life is tied to renewal on a regular basis. The international arrangement also provided for a particular type of trademark dispute. This pertained to dispute with regard to domain names. Domain names are URL or web addresses which could be registered in an entirely different form. So companies which would register a company name under the, say, if it's an Indian company, under the Indian Companies Act, should also register a trademark at the trademark office. Now, if the company needs a domain name, it has to go to a service provider like GoDaddy or Namecheap.com and get the domain name registered. Now, when domain name registration picked up, it was hard for all existing companies to rush and get their domain names registered. In fact, this led to an issue called cyber squatting, where cyber squatters, or people who would register a domain name or a trademark without having any proprietary or ownership rights over it. Now, this was largely done to book the trademark which belonged to another entity and to ask for some kind of a compensation or ransom to give or sell back the domain name. Now, domain name disputes initially was settled through passing off and the trademark law. You could file a case against a squatter who uses the domain name that ought to have belonged to your business and who is refusing to hand it over to you. So you could get an order injuncting the person from using the domain name because the domain name happens to be your trademark or your trade name as well. But the registry for registering domain names, which is the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, ICANN, has a uniform domain name dispute resolution policy. Now, this policy is interesting because the terms of the policy say that if any person raises a complaint to the ICANN saying that their domain name has been used unjustly, then the ICANN policy can have administrative proceedings in which the registrant has to participate, and it has a dispute settle settlement mechanism by which it can settle the dispute. Now, this has been effective in solving thousands of cases pertaining to domain name disputes. Now, the requirements of this administrative proceeding is that the aggrieved party should show that the domain name is similar to their business name or to their trademark, and it has to show that the registrant who had registered it before the legitimate owner registered the domain name, has no rights whatsoever to the domain name, and that it has been registered and it was used in bad faith. So three things to raise a dispute. You can raise a dispute, a domain name dispute, to the ICANN, and this is an administrative proceeding, and the disputes are settled because the terms of the ICANN provide for a dispute settlement mechanism. So the complainant who feels that his business name has been from him by an earlier registrant has to show that the domain name is similar to his business name or his existing business mark. Two, he has to show that the registrant has no rights. Without any right, the registrant had registered the domain name, and the domain name has now been registered and it has been used in bad faith. This has been a very effective proceeding. In fact, some of the reputed trade names in India, for example, the one belonging to Tata, was able to use this mechanism to take back a registration that was unjustly taken away.